I feel like the standard first-year experience with derivatives goes something like this. On the first day, your professor goes on some little spiel about instantaneous velocity, or finding the slope of a function, segueing in a very natural way to a notion of tangent lines or something, and then they say, "And that's what a derivative is." Maybe the professor then talks about approximating tangent lines with secant lines, but at the end of the day, they all eventually get you to some variant of the infamous definition of a derivative. The formula itself makes little sense, but there was so much preliminary buildup of intuition, so maybe you at least believe there's something meaningful there. In any case, though, all that intuition gets completely lost and thrown out the window while you follow the professor work out the derivative of something like x squared. Even if the algebraic manipulations were not challenging, the process is just rote computation, and at no point does it benefit you to know that this is measuring the slope of secant lines of the graph of x squared. At the end of the computation, the answer is 2x, but what does that really mean to you? The next day comes, and your professor teaches you the various rules of differentiation, like the power rule, the product rule, quotient rule, chain rule, or whatever else. Suddenly, the derivative of x squared takes no effort at all, and you can compute derivatives of much more complicated functions with ease.
Wow! Derivatives are actually so easy! Why did the professor waste our time with all that limit stuff earlier?
Mathematics is like putting pineapple on pizza. It seems to generate pretty polarizing opinions, with the general consensus tending towards hatred, fear, and disgust, and the people who like it have a tendency to build a whole personality around it. But why the hate? I mean, regarding mathematics, the whole pineapple on pizza thing speaks for itself. Mathematics has a knack for making people feel stupid. After all, mathematical deductions usually have pretty inflexible rules, and there is typically exactly one correct answer to any problem, in school at least. It might seem like the kind of thing that you either get or don't, and not getting it is somehow conflated with a lack of general intelligence. I don't know, maybe because mathematics is usually thought of as a reflection of one's ability to be logical. Frankly, I would argue that you haven't really done mathematics unless it made you feel stupid. Having an understanding of something is a form of comfort, and I'm told it's normal to want to feel comfortable, but it's dangerous to feel like you understand something in math. Let's go back to the derivatives thing. I reckon that many students who claim to understand derivatives aren't actually comfortable with its definition, and instead are guided by their intuitions about instantaneous velocity and the rules of differentiation. It's a painfully common sentiment among students that time spent on the definition of a derivative is a waste. Why go through all this trouble if we were just going to use these much simpler differentiation rules instead? Well, the answer is that the rules of differentiation simply cannot cover all of the bases of derivatives. Of all the differentiable functions that exist on the real line, only a very tiny subset of them can have their derivatives calculated using these simple rules. Of course, this may be hard to believe, especially when almost all functions you see in a first-year course on calculus is part of the 0% of functions that are really nice, and the only exceptions that get presented to force students to use the limit definition are contrived, piecewise defined functions whose raison d'être is obviously nothing else but to make the undergraduate students miserable. In practice, and in real life, it may very well be the case that most functions you ever encounter are nice, smooth functions where the straightforward rules of differentiation reign supreme. But as a field, mathematics doesn't care about the common case. It cares about the general case. This is something that differentiates mathematics from other fields. If a mathematical result speaks about differentiable functions, they're not just talking about the pleasantries like sine and cosine. They're talking about everything that has a derivative. This is also why mathematics demands more rigor than would seem reasonable. Without having an ironclad argument, how can you otherwise be sure that the argument can withstand unforeseen and potentially hideous examples that can be conjured up? In a way, this is similar to legal documents. The rule of thumb might be something super simple, like, you break it, you buy it. But if you wanted that rule to handle all possible scenarios, things immediately get complicated. What does it really mean to have broken something, and what constitutes buying it? How long could you hold off buying it before you violate the rule? Can someone buy it on your behalf if you break something? The more you think about the edge cases, the less clear the rule of thumb becomes, and all of a sudden, you get a 20-pager in legal speak. My point is, although many mathematical definitions you encounter seem needlessly complicated, the complication really is necessary in the grand scheme of things. But what does this have to do with understanding? Somewhat ironically, I'm not going to define what understanding means. I studied mathematics, not linguistics. But anecdotally, I found that people tend to associate understanding in mathematics with finding it easy. This is dangerous. Mathematics is inherently not easy. Working with theories and definitions whose reach go far beyond what you could ever possibly write down or conceptualize is hard. The only thing that's easy to do in mathematics is, well, to make mistakes, miss details, and leave holes in your arguments. There's a subset of the population with the sentiment that they enjoyed mathematics before it introduced letters and algebra, well, whatever that means. Painful as that might be to hear, can you really blame them? The introduction of variables is the introduction of unknown or arbitrary quantities. The level of generality subsequently increases dramatically. This leads to the all too common situation where a student confusingly receives no credit for work that led to the right answer on the seemingly unreasonable basis that this line of reasoning does not work in general. Does this curse of generality mean that people who do study mathematics are in a whole other intellectual league? I wish, but unfortunately for me, that isn't true. There are certainly unfathomably intelligent mathematicians, as are there unbelievably talented people in any profession. But mathematics is not some sort of smart kids-only club. The only barriers to mathematics are social. But maybe let's not go down that rabbit hole today. Having spent the majority of my adult life among graduate students in pure fields of mathematics, a common trend I observe among the strongest of them is that their self-confidence is kinda low. They don't think highly of themselves, and they certainly don't think they're intelligent. Maybe this will change after they land a tenure-track position at a decent university, but most of my friends, and myself of course, have spent the majority of our graduate years feeling totally incompetent. Although I really do wish my friends could see how talented they are, I want to stress the dangers of feeling smart in mathematics. As I've already said, the scope of most mathematical concepts is far broader than anyone could reasonably grasp, unless of course you were built different. But let's face it, most people in mathematics are built the same. There's hubris in believing that, in something so brief as a lifetime, you'll somehow completely understand a concept of mathematics. I know I'm really going to town with differential calculus as my example, but consider the following statement. If a function is differentiable at a point A, then it is continuous at A. Intuitively, a function is differentiable at a point if, at that point, the function is kind of smooth, in that its graph doesn't have any jagged corners. On the other hand, a function is continuous at a point if, at that point, the function can be drawn with a pencil without ever leaving the page. From this intuition, the statement seems obvious. To be able to draw a function with no jagged corners, you have to at least be able to draw the function at all, so clearly differentiability at that point implies it must be continuous there too. However, this oversimplified line of reasoning might lead you to believe a slightly more general statement. If a function is differentiable at a point A, then it is continuous in a neighborhood of A. After all, to be able to have or not have a corner, you need to look at a small neighborhood of the point already, and if you were drawing a smooth curve in this neighborhood, then you must already have a connected curve in that neighborhood, so differentiability obviously implies continuity in a small window. This is a great and intuitive statement about derivatives, with its only deficiency being that it is incorrect. It's possible for a function to be differentiable at a point and only continuous at the same point. Intuition can inevitably lead you astray, but had you instead felt that you did not understand derivatives very well and were given this problem, you would have no choice but to rely on the definition of the derivative and the definition of continuity, and then you would find difficulty in proving that this statement is true, as ultimately it isn't true. Counterexamples to this claim are impossible to sketch in any remotely faithful way, so anything other than a rigorous approach would not be able to determine the validity of this statement. This kind of problem isn't limited to undergraduates. Being rigorous is cumbersome, and the further along in mathematics you get, the more you take rigor for granted. For first-year students in mathematics, the level of rigor expected in proofs is remarkably higher than that of a fourth-year student. This is mostly because students fresh out of high school most likely have no clue how to really do mathematics beyond performing rote calculations, and they need to earn the right to leave out details. The older you get, the more often you find yourself reaching for the forbidden words. Clear, evident, trivial, obvious, etc. People are inherently lazy and won't be thorough if they feel they don't have to be. After studying mathematics for years, or even decades, surely you've gotten a knack for how mathematical arguments flow, and you've got a lot of results to publish, so there's no need to waste time writing down trivial steps in between, right? Reaching for a proof by seniority or authority has other pitfalls, as even the most prolific mathematicians can end up making critical errors, and their title leads these errors to publications. Such errors are not unusual, and you can't really blame the mathematicians who make these mistakes. After all, to err is human, and the reviewers cannot possibly be that thorough. Though maybe they'd be more careful if the journal actually paid them for their review. It is errors like these that drove Vladimir Voivodsky, a Fields medalist who studied homotopy theory and algebraic geometry, to pivot into researching the development of a computer proof assistant for homotopy theory. In collaboration with Mikhail Kapranov, Voivodsky had, somewhat famously, published a proof for a result that essentially claimed that all homotopy types could be represented by strict infinity groupoids in 1991. In 1998, though, Carlos Simpson proved that the homotopy type of the two-sphere, well, I guess normal people would call that a sphere, could not be represented by strict infinity groupoids, demonstrating that Kapranov and Voivodsky's proof could not be correct. But gee, I hear you say, if it really is impossible to understand anything in mathematics, then how are we supposed to do math? Carefully. Care must be taken to show the mathematical subject the respect it deserves, but also, care must be given to yourself when you mess things up or get confused. Nobody is immune to these mistakes, no matter how long you've been in the field. While achieving a complete understanding is as unattainable of a goal as achieving perfection, your experience and mistakes will sharpen your intuition. Mathematics is something you just have to get used to. Intuition about mathematical objects comes not from your professor explaining these objects through analogy, but rather from your personal, exhausting, and sometimes emotional battles with these objects. People often praise the likes of Euler and Gauss for their mathematical genius, but many forget that they also spent an absurd amount of time working through arduous calculations by hand, and it's likely also thanks to this tedium that they had such a strong sense of direction in the subject. Anyway, if you're still here, thank you for watching. If you're wondering what you've been watching me type, this document here is penance for something I said when I was young and foolish. If you liked what you watched, or listened to, I admire your patience. If you didn't like what you watched, it's fine. The favor of the general masses is something I'll probably never gain an understanding of, but remaining on the good side of a particular individual will always be a breeze.